Right, 1 John chapter 4, because it's the love year. Let's look at a few stuff. Got my little board here. Verse 4, say this is God's word, and I'm going to be edified, I'm going to be built up, I'm going to be blessed, I'm going to be prosperous, I'm going to be successful, and I'm going to be totally well. Strong in the Lord, in the power of His might. Amen. 1 John 4, verse 4. Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world. Scriptures we know so well. Verse 8. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Everybody say, God is love. For God is love. In this was manifested the love of God towards us, because that God sent His only begotten Son into the world that we might live through Him. So I just want to throw this in right at the beginning, for maybe there's people here that are not saved. But John 3 verse 16 says, God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. And this is more or less what it says here. Herein is love. You know, that not that we love God, but God loved us and gave His Son for us so that we through Him might live. I want to admonish you and ask you tonight, right now, where you sit. Don't wait for the end of the meeting. If you want Jesus to come into your life, right now say, Jesus Christ, come into my life. Forgive me my sin. I receive your grace to bring me a new life. The blood of Jesus to cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Right now, I make Jesus Christ Lord of my life. I receive you as my personal Savior. My past is forgotten. I've got a new life. Amen. If you've prayed that prayer, I want to help you. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if any man is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old have passed away. Behold, all things have become new, and your sins are forgiven. You are free. Don't let anybody put any bondage on you. If you've prayed that prayer, I declare all across the world in this house, your sins are forgiven. You are free. You're a child of God. Okay, let's get back to our message. God is love. That's where we were. Verse 10, herein is love, not that we loved God, but that He loved us, and sent His Son to be a propitiation for our sins. Okay, verse 17, herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as He is, so are we in this world. God is love. Is that more or less what he says there in verse 8? Now in 1 Corinthians 13, verse 13, we all know the scripture. He says, now abideth faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Then chapter 14, verse 1 of 1 Corinthians says, follow after love. Okay? Now abideth faith, hope, and love. The greatest, of course, is love. Now we know God is love. Then 14 verse 1, follow after love. What is love? Okay, so there am I. Okay, I must follow something. God. But God is love. Follow after love. And if I follow, you heard the story years ago, I talked about it, something will have to follow me too. You know? I will have a following. But I want to help you tonight. If I got to follow after love, it means I got to follow after God. Why? Because God is love. Okay? So Hebrews chapter 12 verse 2 says something else. We're going to come to that 13 verse 13. 1 Corinthians 13 verse 13. He says, in Hebrews 12, verse 2 in the Amplified Bible, it says, look away from all that will distract by looking unto Jesus, the leader and the source of our faith. Okay? So I must look away from everything that wants to distract me by looking unto Jesus. Who is Jesus? He's God. Okay, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. So Jesus and God's the same person. Okay, so I must look to Jesus. What do I get when I look to Jesus? Hebrews chapter 12 verse 2 says, He's the leader. Okay, so if He leads, so simple, then it means I follow. What is He the leader of? He's the leader of my faith. Okay, what abides? Faith, hope, and love. The greatest of these is love. God is love. So follow after love, so follow after God. Because we must look away from all that will distract by looking to who? Jesus. What is Jesus in this case? He's the leader. So if I look at the leader, I must follow him. If I look away, it means I can't follow him. But if I do follow him, what does he lead me to? He leads me to faith. He's the leader and the source of my faith. So the more I look to Jesus, the more my faith will just be there. We have heard so many messages of how I can increase faith, how I can have more faith, how I must operate in faith. But at the end, so very little people operate in faith. We still look at circumstances, but the righteous shall live by faith. How do I get my faith to be in operation 24/7? I look away from everything that'll take my eyes away from love, from God, from faith. So if I look at my leader, I automatically will have faith because he's the leader of my faith. So I follow him. Okay, so a good scripture in this, I'm just going to go on and on and on. I hope I'm going to get to the message that I've prepared. But Galatians 5 verse 6 says the following. It says, it's not circumcision, neither uncircumcision that availeth anything, but faith that worketh by love. Oh, you're going to get it. 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 Let's put it quickly there. There's God. There's love. There's Jesus. One thing. Okay, God is love. Okay, he's the leader. What am I? I follow. I will follow him. Remember? Follow him wherever he may go. I love him. Remember, what's that sister act? How many remember the sister act? I mean, you're not all so holy, man. Some of you watch the movie. Come on, man. Come on, come on. You watch the sister act. I follow. Maybe you should show it in church one night. Okay. If I do, something will follow me. Man, we're going to get to that in a minute, okay? So, I follow God. God is love. He's the author or the leader of my faith. Now I say Galatians 5 verse 16 says, faith works by love. Okay, it's not uncircumcision, neither circumcision. So many people get caught up in religion. This religion attack that one attack that one. Oh, you law. No, I'm grace. No, I'm grace. No, you grace. No, I'm law. No, you grace. God says it doesn't matter. Does your faith operate by love? Now, how does faith operate by love? Who is love? God is love. Who is Jesus? The leader of my faith. So if faith operates by love, it means God is the leader and the source of my faith. So in other words, it's him that's doing it through me. I am just looking to him. And if my eyes are on him and it looks away from distraction, faith will always be in operation. Faith works by love. Works is sometimes a labor. You can spell it with an O or with an OU. For those who know the English Bible still don't know how to spell. You know, they spell it in different ways. Okay, faith that operates by love. Hebrews 6:10 says, God is not unrighteous to forget your labor of love. Okay, God is not unrighteous to forget your labor of love. So if God is not unrighteous, then it means he's righteous. So God is then also, let's make the circle bigger. God is also righteousness. Is that true? And I think 1 Timothy 6:16 as well as 2 Timothy 2:22. That's easy to remember. 1 Timothy 6:16, 2 Timothy 2:22. That's easy to remember. Both of those scriptures says, follow after righteousness. Does it make sense? Okay, so I follow after righteousness, righteousness. I follow after God, I follow after love, I follow after Jesus. Why? Because he's the leader and source of my faith. So if I look at that, I will never stumble, I will never fall, because distractions will not have any say in my life. My life will be driven. The righteous shall live by faith. I live by faith. Why? Because God is doing something in me. It's not my religious ideas. Is where is my eyes focused? Is it on the leader? Is it on the author of my faith? Man, let's, Isaiah 58. Let's do it. Isaiah 58. Too much now. Ooh. I know where I'm going. Do you know where you're going? We're going to the pool. Isaiah 58, verse 8. Okay, now I want you to listen from now, because every verse is totally weighed off for tonight's meeting, for you to get whatever you must get from God. There will be prosperity, there will be healing, there will be blessings. Everything will be incorporated somewhere in this message, so take note. Isaiah 58, verse 8. Then shall your light break forth as the morning. How many feel they're sitting in darkness? Your health shall spring forth speedily. Righteousness, your righteousness shall go before you. Who is your righteousness? God is your righteousness. Okay, he shall go before you. If he goes before you, what are you doing? Following him. Huh? He shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be thy reward. Amplified, rear guard, some of the later translations, follow. Oh my goodness, so there we have something that will follow us. Glory. In other words, if I follow God, if I follow righteousness, if I follow Jesus as my leader, and he's my righteousness, he's my everything, if I follow him and my eyes are totally on him, I live by faith. And if I look around, I say, whew, glory. Whew, glory. Glory. You know, what are you saying when you look? Oh. Okay, I couldn't say that in church, but you know what you said. You know, oh, blessed assurance. Okay, I don't know what you said. But, you know, people say stuff. Now, glory, I don't want to run ahead of myself. But in John chapter 2 and in John chapter 11, Jesus said something to this effect. When he turned the water into wine, the Bible says, Jesus did this first miracle at Cana at Galilee, where he turned the water into wine and showed forth his glory. Remember John 1:14, the word became flesh and we beheld his glory. How did they behold his glory? At the turning of the water into wine. John chapter 11, Lazarus is dead, 4 days, Martha and Mary has an awesome testimony, he stinketh. Okay, so this is their witness, this man is dead. And Jesus says to the sisters, have I not told you, if you would believe, you'd see the glory of God. Lazarus, come forth. When the guy came out, what did they say? Whew, glory. So, glory is then signs, wonders, and miracles. Okay, let's read on. Glory shall follow. Verse 11. And the Lord, okay, you got to get this. And the Lord shall guide thee continually and satisfy your soul in drought. And make fat your bones. That doesn't mean they're going to push you around in a wheelbarrow. That means you're going to be anointed. Okay, if my bones are fat, it means I'm anointed with the oil of the Holy Ghost. Listen to this. And you shall be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters fail not. So if this is accomplished, I am like a spring, like a fountain. A river. Oh, man. And what does it do? It'll fail not. What's that song that we sing? When it goes to the left, goes to the right. Deep cries out, deep cry out, deep cry out. You know? What does it say? Because there's rivers. There's fountains. There's springs. Jesus says to the woman at the well, if you drink of the water that I will give you, it will come on the inside of you, a spring, a well of living water springing up into eternal life. He said at the last day of the great feast, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. Okay? So if glory follow me, if I follow him, if signs and wonders and miracles is then the glory that follow, then Mark 16 comes to being. 16 verse 16. To them that believe, these signs shall follow. They shall cast out demons out. Whew, glory. They shall speak in new tongues. Repra shekalama. Oh, glory. They shall lay hands on the sick. Oh, and they shall recover. Ha, glory. They shall take up serpents and it shall not bite them. Ah, glory. They shall take up poison and drink it. Oh, ha, ha, glory. It shall not hurt them. But I gotta follow him. I will follow him wherever he may go. Where he leads me, I will. Suits me. I will follow if it doesn't rain today. Where he leads me, I will follow. I'm not going to give my money to the church. Where he leads me, I will follow. It's very hot today. I'm not going. Here he leads. Okay, the beautiful thing of Mark 16 is the following. Mark 16 says, and they went all over. In other words, they now following him. So somebody is going to follow him, follow them. And the Bible says, and the Lord worked with them, confirming the word with signs. Following, okay? The Lord worked with them, confirming the word with signs following. Now, I want to put it this way. How would you like the Lord, God Almighty, the creator of the universe, the awesome Father, the wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace, the Rose of Sharon, or whatever you want to call him, the Bright Morning Star, the Lily of the Valley, oh man, oh the Star, oh the Son of Righteousness, whatever you want to call him, how would you like him to start operating when you follow him? And oh, whoa, man, whoa, wow, how would you like it? I want to say it like that. It'll take the pressure off. Okay, a few of you need it. I can see the frown is nearly splitting your head in two. But listen, how would you like to get the pressure off of your work and off of your labor? Now remember, God is not unrighteous to forget our labor of love. But how would you like your labor to be filled with rest and peace and not to sweat? You remember in Genesis, God said, you know, cursed shall be the ground because for your sakes, and in the sweat of your brow, you're going to eat your bread. Are you, man, now I want to eat bread. Now I first got to take the sweat off. You know, you eat that bread, you put half of it away. You know, I sweated all month to buy you that bread. Our children were small. My in-laws were staying with us for a while. And we always heard on the news about the hunger in Ethiopia and saw these little boys and babies with their bloated tummies because of, you know, underfeeding and, you know. And, you know, Kubis and Joanki were sitting there. Petrus was a baby and, you know, they just didn't want to eat. Eat your food. Pumpkin give you red cheeks. Carrot give you strong eyes, you know. Have you ever seen a blind rabbit? You know, and stuff like it, you know. And all the stuff, you know, going with it. And they just didn't want to eat. So my father-in-law says, you're doing it the wrong way. Give them to me. I'll get them to eat. So Annelise says, you get them to eat. So my father-in-law says, my children, listen, in Ethiopia, it's so bad. Those children have got nothing to eat. Chrissy said, well, send them the food. That's good. I mean, why should we struggle to eat when, you know, we got surplus? I mean, send the food to them. Why must we struggle to eat the stuff if we don't want to eat it? Wise. Okay, but listen to this. I'm just trying to say, how would you like to get the pressure of the stuff you're doing and for a change, have your eyes on Him and see glory following you? You follow Him and glory follow you. It works like this. Revelation 14, 13. I'm just going to quote it. He says, blessed are the dead in Christ. Who's the dead in Christ? Oh, the people that are dead. The context is people that's alive. So Paul says, I'm dead. Yet I live. Yet not I, but Christ is alive in me. Paul says, I die daily. Okay, so blessed are the dead in Christ that die. Because, listen to this, they rest from their labor and works follow them. You gotta get the revelation. Blessed are the people that's not trying to do everything by their own power, but they realize I'm dead. It's not I that live, but Christ is alive in me. I'm going to die myself. I'm not going to try and force it. Oh, get the sick healed, my brother, in the name of Jesus. In the name of... Ooh, Ricky, shiki, beauty. In the name... Devil, I bind you, you foul, wicked spirit of darkness. I bind you now. I bind you. I bind you. I bind you. I curse you. I cast you out. I bind you. In Jesus' name, come out. How do you feel? No, the pain is still there. Oh, in the name. But blessed are the dead that die in Christ. Because they rest from the labor and their works just follow them. So you just walk up to a skinny guy that's dying and you say, hey, I like your buckle. Nice cowboy buckle. Ha! Huh. Oh, sorry, you didn't walk for a week. Ha! Huh. Bless you. I just showed you that clip. No, just lift the man up. He hasn't drank water. Just take water, just a little sip. Not so much. Okay, walk a little. That's good. Ha, drink some more water. Yeah, not so much. Did you see any sweat? Any labor? Or is it the rest? So blessed are the people that are dead and die in Christ. They rest from the labor and their works. Just follow them. So when they show the clip, everyone say, oh, glory. Oh, glory. Have you ever saw a sweating miracle in this house? I remember the first night Tom Scarella visited us there in the old church. And I said to him, you know, we had a miracle service. I said, you take that line, I'll take this line. So I'm going blessed, healed, free, come out, be blessed, free, walk. Just get up, walk, walk, walk. Okay, next one, come, you know, throw away your crutches, walk, walk. And I looked around and there's Tom coming to me. His eyes this big and there's a woman on the floor. And he goes, Prophet Kubis, please, could you come help? And there's the whole line still standing. So I walk over and I put my foot on the woman's stomach and I say, peace! And doop, says she falls. And I walk away and he comes. He says, how did you do that? I said, peace. Oh, so the devil is now out. I said, yes, he's gone. The devil's got no rest. So if you speak peace, that sucker's got to go. How do I know that? Easy. Matthew 12, remember 43, 45, the Bible says, when the evil spirit goes out, he goes to desert places and looking for rest, but he can't find any. He just can't find rest. He's a restless, you know what? You can add your adjectives, but he's a restless, devil. Okay, so the Bible says, then he comes back to his own house where he came from. And when he sees it's empty, he goes away and quickly finds seven worse than him. It means seven unrestful spirits. I mean, imagine the hyperactivity, the agitation, the frustration, the HDD, HPP, Ritalin, you add everything to it, and he comes with all those back to you. And we find the house empty, he says, let's add. And you get more frustrated and more unrestful. That's why the Bible says, do not get drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit. So if he comes back and he finds me filled, what will I have when I'm filled? I will have peace. Righteousness, peace, joy in the Holy Ghost. Okay, blessed are the dead in Christ, that die in Christ, because they rest from their labor and their works to follow them. Hebrews 4:11 says, this is now a total different avenue. Hebrews 4:11 says, labor to enter the rest. Now, how do I labor to enter into rest? Easy. I just know what Jesus said. In Matthew 11:28, we were just in Matthew 12, but in Matthew 11:28, Jesus says the following, come unto me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Now, I know we put that in, oh man, if you are depressed and if you are heavy laden, come unto Jesus. Jesus put two categories in there. Come unto me, all ye labor. In other words, come unto me, all ye that work. Come on, take it to the thing tonight. Come unto me, everybody that works, and I will give you rest. So God wants you to rest in whatever you do, not to be anxious, frustrated, filled with fear, and and breaking the pencils, and pulling out your hair, and screaming at the furniture. God says, hey, peace. I mean, maybe God doesn't say it that way. Maybe God says, peace. I don't know, but I mean, peace. God says, you can rest. And if you rest in your labor, the works that are filled with glory will start following you, because you have been looking away from distractions and your eyes have been focused on Jesus, the leader and the source of your faith, who is God, who is love. For the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. And the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, and peace. So God wants you to have rest. Rest, just go to Isaiah 57, just a page back. Verse 18, he says, I have seen his ways and will heal him. I will lead him also and will restore comforts unto him. Verse 19, I create the fruit of the lips, peace, peace, to him that is far off and to him that is near, saith the Lord, and I will heal him. Okay? So I want to help you. If you want a miracle and you struggle to get your miracle, point number one, get the rest and the peace back. In anxiety, I have not yet seen people really healed. In frustration, I don't really see miracles. But people that just, that's why I make jokes when I minister to the sick. That's why I try to get their attention away from their sickness. You got a nice cowboy buckle on, brother. Who's this? Your brother? Oh, shame. Look at the man. He's so skinny. So he feels I feel sorry for him. No, I'm not sorry for him. I'm just, he's so skinny. Yo, look at this man. You can shoot his legs both off with one match. I make jokes. What do? I get peace in this situation. And then I say, just sir, look at me, just get up. You know, get up. No screaming, no shouting, no frustration. Just get up, sir. And then they get up and say, ah, work. You're walking. Eh. Where's the pain? Eh. That scripture is quoted in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 17. You know, 8 and 9 says, by grace are you saved through faith. It's not of yourself. It's a gift of God, not by works that any man should boast. And then verse 17 says the following. He says, he came to preach peace to those that are far and those that were near by the cross of his blood, or the blood of his cross. So the blood of the cross say, hey, peace. If I see the cross, it spells peace to me. It says, be filled with rest. Get out of your rush. Get into a restful place. Don't be so stressful. Be restful. That's a good slogan. It'd make a nice t-shirt. Don't be stressful. Be restful. Not rip. You missed that one. Not rest in peace. Be at peace. Everybody say, peace, man.
Peace.
What I'm trying to say tonight is we need a revival of God's love, God's peace, God's joy. They did a test at a university in America once, and they went around the campus and they asked the students, tell me the three things you need the most. And you know what? Without exception, it was the first three things of the fruit of the Spirit. Maybe in different order, but everybody said, I want love and peace and joy. Another one said, I want joy and peace and love. Another one said, I want peace and love and joy. But when they came to the end of the day, that was the three things that everybody wanted. Love, peace, joy. The fruit of the Spirit is love, peace, joy. You know the rest. Long-suffering, gentleness, kindness, meekness, temperance, faith. Against such there is no law. Say revival of love, revival of peace, revival of joy. I'm getting somewhere. Let's go to Hosea. He's from South America. Healings already taking place. As people are getting peace, stuff is already disappearing. As you receive peace and get your focus right and your attention away from the distraction. You know, sickness is a distraction, man. Problems is a distraction. Poverty is a distraction. Debt is a distraction. How would you like? Did you know that the bank that you owe money to, there's people that save money in that bank? That's a revelation. That safe that's got papers that says you owe. There's papers that says I owe them. There's people that's got money in the bank. How would you like to exchange from debt to money? Go to the bank and, you know. How would you like that ATM not to be so full of excuses? Because every time you come there, he says, sorry. I mean, there's nothing that's got as good manners as an ATM. I mean, you stand there, you would see how many people stand there and that ATM, sorry. Sorry, I mean, the most polite machine on the face of the earth. Hosea 6. Why are you laughing? Did it speak to you lately? How would you like your ATM to say, come see the bank manager. We need to make plans. The money's to get too much in your account. Yeah. I remember the bank manager phoned me once and said, you must come here. You can't sit with this check account. We need to change it. I said, oh my goodness, what's wrong? He said, you've got too much money. I said, ah, that's good. Hosea 6. Come and let us return unto the Lord. For he hath torn and he will heal us. He hath smitten and he will bind us up. After 2 days, he will revive us. In the third day, he will raise us up, and we shall live in his sight. then shall we know if we follow on to know the Lord. His going forth is prepared as the morning. He shall come unto us as the rain, as the latter and the former rain up to the earth. He says, if we really know to follow the Lord, I will follow him. He will come to us like rain, like the former rain and the latter rain. Zechariah 10 verse 1, pray ye the Lord for rain in the time of the latter rain. I make the lightnings and I will cause showers to come to you, says the Lord God Almighty. Joel chapter 2 verse 21 through 28, fear not, O land, be glad and rejoice, for the Lord is sending you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain. Afterwards I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Come on, we shall see visions and dreams. Oh man, and what does he say? Your barns shall be full of plenty, and your vats will overflow with new wine, and you shall not have lack in any sense. Abundance. Hallelujah. Isaiah 42. Okay, there's more scriptures I can quote, but I think that's good enough. Isaiah 42. Oh. I, the Lord, have called thee in righteousness, and I will hold your hand. Okay, this is just for fast thinkers. If I follow righteousness, if the Lord is my righteousness, if he is love, if he is God, if he is the leader, and I follow him, and he comes to me like rain, if he is my guide, if he is my teacher, if I follow him. Now, there he says, you know, what did I read? He called me in righteousness. If he calls me in righteousness and holds my hand, it means I can't but follow him. I can't but follow him. Verse 7. To open the blind eyes, to bring out the prisoners from the prison, and them that sit in darkness out of the prison house. I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory will I not give to another. Okay. God says he has called us. He's going to take us by the hand. We're going to follow him. He says, because my glory, I will not give to another. Now, I remember when I got saved in the charismatic movement, I had a book by a very famous preacher, My Glory I Will Not Give to Another. Man, this thing put you in a false humility. I walked around like a worm. You know, oh God, sorry that I'm on the earth. Oh, forgive me that I'm existing. Oh God, the glory is the Lord. Oh, the glory is the Lord. Oh, I'm just this worm. And somebody said, you must watch it. The devil may go fishing with you. You know, because I'm this little worm, you know. I mean, if you this worm and you in the image of God, does God come through the clouds like a worm and he's going, Big cat, small kittens. Big fish, small fish. Big God, small. Ye are gods. Psalm 82, 6. John 10, 34, does not your law say, I say you are God's? Okay, God says, I will not give my glory to another. But he said the glory is going to follow us. The glory is going to be our rear guard. John 17, Jesus prays, Father, I have given them thy glory. But there he says, I will not give my glory to another. Yes, I will not give my glory to someone that is not following me in the grace message. You know, because Galatians 1 and 2 says, how is it that you are so soon removed from the gospel that I've preached to you to another? Okay, God is not giving his glory to people who want to impress him with the works of the law. But God is giving his glory to the people that trust in the grace. Paul says in 2 Timothy 2 verse 1, he says, you must stand in this grace. You must force yourself to stay in this grace. You must fight for this grace. You must stay in grace. Don't go back to the works of the law. It's going to tire you out. It's going to make you full of stress and anxiety and fear, and you're going to be hyperactive. Johnny's it still. No. We are in Isaiah 42. I am the Lord, I will not give my glory to another. Here it comes, to the last portion of the message, I hope. Behold, the former things are come to pass. New things do I declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. Sing unto the Lord, a new song. Now, where do you hear the new song? Revelation 5, verse 9. And they sang a new song unto the Lord, say, worthy is the Lamb that was slain and has washed us in his own blood and made us to be kings and priests unto our God, and we shall reign on this earth. This is the new song. The Lamb is worthy, but I've been made a king and a priest. I follow him. He's the King of the kings. He's the Lord of the lords. I follow him, and glory follows me. I'll prove it to you. Just go to the next chapter. No, let's stay in the chapter. Verse 16. I will bring the blind by a way that they knew not. In other words, they will see. I will lead them in paths that they have not known. Listen to the word lead. I will make darkness light before them, crooked things straight. These things will I do unto them and not forsake them. Verse 22. But this is a people robbed and spoiled, all of them snared in holes that they are hid in prison houses. Now he just said they're going to come out of the prison. They are for a prey and none deliver for the spoil, and none say restore. Who among you will give ear to this? Who will hearken and hear for the time to come? He says, when I gave the prophecy, nobody wanted to take the word and say restore. But in the time to come, is there somebody that will hear the prophetic word and say restore? Oh God, give us ways to walk in. Remove the darkness. Take away the stress, the sickness. Take away the lack and the shortage. Restore. Chapter 43, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. Through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon you. Verse 18, remember not the former things, neither consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing for the second time. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers. Come on, rivers in the desert. Isn't this where we were? You shall be like a spring, like a fountain, like a river. When you follow love, when you follow God, when you follow Christ, when you follow righteousness, the leader, your faith will then work by love. Your labor will be restful. You will rest in your labor and works will follow you. You will not have seven worse demons coming into you. You will have the Holy Spirit taking control of you. Rivers, 48. We're still in Isaiah. 48, 16. Come ye near unto me. Hear ye this. I have not spoken in secret from the beginning, from the time that it was, there am I. And now from the time that, and now the Lord God and his Spirit has sent me. Thus saith the Lord your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. I am the Lord your God, which teacheth thee to profit, which leadeth thee by a way that thou should go. God says, if you follow me where I lead you, I'm going to teach you how to profit. Why? Because my sheep hear my voice. John 10 verse 3, John 10 verse 4, John 10 verse 5, John 10 verse 17. My sheep hear my voice. I call them out and they follow me. Where does he lead them to? The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. If you follow me, I will teach you how to profit. God will show you how you can have more, how you can have abundance, how you can have an overflow. How can you be in a place without lack, without shortage? Come on, man, don't you think we need it? The other night we watched the program on the drug lords there in some countries, you know. Those guys on the streets of America, they get the drugs from certain places. They make $17,000 a day. And that's not the lords. That's just the people selling. $17,000. There's enough money. It's in the wrong hands. Come look at your hands. Say, God's going to teach me to profit. Because I'm going to follow him. That thou mayest say to the prisoners, go forth. To them that are in darkness, show yourselves. They shall feed in the ways, and their pastures shall be in high places. Here it comes. They shall not hunger, nor thirst. neither shall the heat nor the sun smite them. For he that hath mercy on them shall lead them, even by the springs of water shall he guide them. Okay, God is saying to you tonight, Church of the Lord Jesus Christ, there's a place in God where we follow him, where we shall not hunger, where we shall not thirst. In other words, we shall profit. We shall have no lack. There shall no heat be scourging us. The sun shall not strike us by day, neither the moon by night. For he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Because I shall say of the Lord, my rock and my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. There he's going to give his angels charge over thee. You shall not be struck by the sun by day, neither by the moon by night, neither by the pestilence that walketh at noonday. Nothing shall hurt you, because God's gonna bless you. For he that hath mercy on them shall lead them by the springs. Revelation 7. Hallelujah. After this, verse 9, I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations, all kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. Does the Bible say that we are clothed with white raiment and white robes? Did Jesus make our robes white in his blood? Come on, scripture of Ephesians, Colossians, Revelation 1, Revelation 5. He made our clothes white. Okay? So we just allowed the blood to come. Wash me and whiter than snow shall I be. Come, let us reason together, say the Lord. Though your sins be red like scarlet, they shall be white like snow, and so forth, and so forth. Okay? So, a multitude with their robes white. Must I do it, Jesus? Yes, son, go for it. Verse 13, and one of the elders answered, saying unto me, what are these which are arrayed in white robes, and whence come they? And I said unto him, sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, these are they which come out of great tribulation. Now that word has put a lot of people on a sidetrack, and they build a whole doctrine on a tribulation that's supposed to come. And have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Have you washed your robes and made them white? And the previous saints, and the previous saints, and the previous saints, since the crucifixion, everybody that came to Jesus have washed their robes. But the word tribulation jumped in there, and everybody's on the sidetrack about the tribulation, and we missed the message. Verse 16, they shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. I thought this was written twice in the book of Isaiah as a prophecy when Messiah should come and the church should be born. Is there anybody in the house? You know, I thought I just read you the prophecies about that. Now he says, these are the people that have washed their robes. They will not hunger nor thirst. The heat shall not strike them. They shall learn to profit. I mean, not one of these things are needed in heaven. It's quiet. Not one of these things are needed in heaven. If you want to die and go to heaven, it's perfect. Okay. For the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, shall lead them unto living fountains of waters, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. Is Jesus going to lead you when you go into heaven to waters and say, my son, come drink? No? Or is he our shepherd that leads us now? I mean, I read you scripture upon scripture upon scripture upon scripture. Let's go to Revelation 21. Verse 3, and I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. So it can't be heaven. Christ is now in us, the mystery that's been hidden throughout ages. God is with men. He will dwell with them. They shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them. Now that is 1 Peter chapter 1. That is Romans chapter 9 to 11. Over and over, God said, I will be with them. They shall be my children. I shall be their God, etc. He says, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying. neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. Now, I read it to you three times in the book of Isaiah. That is a prophecy for the church and not for heaven. That is a prophecy for the cross of Christ and not the life hereafter.
Preach it, man. Preach.
Is that true? Okay. The former things are passed away. Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, it is done. Where did he cry that? On the cross. I'm Alpha and Omega, beginning and end. I will give unto him that is thirsty of the fountain of the water of life freely. Yes. 22, verse 17. And the Spirit and the Bride says, come. Let him that hears say, come. And let him that is thirst come. And who is ever will, let him take of the water of life freely. Psalm 23. All I'm saying is God says, you're not going to be hungry. You're not going to be thirsty. Nothing's going to burn on you. You're not going to be stressful. You're not going to be filled with anxiety and fear. You're not going to be sick. You're not going to be sitting in prison houses. You're not going to be sitting in darkness. You're not going to have sorrow. You're not going to cry. There's going to be no more tears. There's going to be no more lack. I'm going to teach you to profit. I'm telling you the message was about God wants you to prosper, be happy, be in the light, be healthy, be prosperous, be successful. No, man, God don't want you to be in other stuff. God don't want you to be in a prison house. That's more rest. And everything is going to the waters. Going to the waters. He's going to lead us to waters. He's going to lead us to waters. So tonight, we're going to manifest it at our pool. And we're going to say, I'm going to follow him to the water. And if I walk through the water, glory's got to follow me. In other words, signs and wonders and miracles and prosperity and peace and power got to follow me when I come out of that pool tonight. Okay? Just as a manifestation. Why must we manifest? Because God says in Hosea 12 verse 10, prophets act out their parables, and people that follow that prophet, that parables that are acted out by prophets will profit. 2 Chronicles 20 verse 20, believe in God and you shall be established, believe in his prophets and so shall you prosper. So prophets, if people don't believe in manifestations, it's a sure proof that they're not a prophet. They may be a pastor, but pastor takes them to green pastures. Okay. Psalm 23. So what are they? Schizophrenics. I don't know. I like manifestations. Don't you? It's a tangible thing. It's something that you can touch. Why did Paul send, you know, cloths and aprons to the people and they got healed and demons were cast out of them? Psalm 23, we all know it. Let's read. I'm going to read it in the Amplified. The Lord is my shepherd to feed me, to guide me, to shield me. I shall not lack. He makes me lie down in fresh, tender, green pastures. He leads me beside still and restful waters. He refreshes and restores my life, myself. He leads me in the path of righteousness, uprightness and right standing with him, not for my earning it, grace, but for his name's sake. Yes, though I walk through the deep, sunless valley of the shadow of death, I will fear or dread no evil, for you are with me. Your rod to protect and your staff to guide me, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely, or only goodness, mercy, unfailing love shall follow me all the days of my life. And through the length of my days, the house of the Lord and his presence shall be my dwelling place. I follow the shepherd, my leader. I mean, that wasn't deep, was it? I mean, anybody could take that word. It's so simple and so easy, you know? And I just thought, Psalm 23. My shepherd's going to lead me. I'm going to have no lack. I'm going to have no want. He's going to take me to restful waters. that's going to manifest the springs, the wells, the rivers, the new thing. Behold, the former things have passed away. The new has come. Rain is going to be my portion. Rivers of springs of living rivers, water is going to be my portion. No hunger, no thirst, no lack. I will profit. I will be blessed. I will be healed. I will not be sitting in a prison. I will be free. I will be liberated. The grace of God is going to be my portion. I'm not going to labor with sweat anymore. I'm going to rest from my labor, and works will just follow. Follow me. Emphasize it. Goodness and mercy shall follow me. Goedheid en guns sal my volg. Goodness and mercy. When Moses wanted to see the glory of God in Exodus 33 and 34, God says, my goodness will pass before you. And the Bible says it was a fading glory, but there came a glory that should follow. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. He says, and as God came, he shouted out his name and said, the Lord is good, and his mercies endure forever. And Moses fell on his face and he said, oh, the glory. Okay, later on, God wanted to kill the children of Israel, Numbers chapter 14. And God says, Moses, allow me to destroy them because they are hard-headed people. Moses says, no, you can't, because you said you are good and your mercies endure forever when I met you on the mountain. God says, because of that word, I can't destroy them. But as truly as I live, my glory shall fill all the earth. So what is God saying? If goodness and mercy follow me, it's glory.